This water main break is a very difficult one to repair. The pipeline goes as deep as 16 to 18 feet deep. So we've dug a hole that's a very big hole and very deep hole. We're in the process right now of working to open up two lanes. And to the traffic, right now we have one lane open eastbound, but by this afternoon before rush hour, we hope to have a second lane open for the community.
What's making it so difficult?
The difficulty is that the pipeline that broke is actually a pipeline that is going down deeper into the ground. So it's going actually at the other end of the pipeline, goes under the stream next to us, and gets to the other side of the stream. So the pipeline is slanted downward into the trench, making the hole very deep. Like I mentioned, about 16 or 18 feet deep right now. The pipe is made out of cast iron. It was installed in 1969, and unfortunately it broke at probably the worst place it could break. How long to do the repairs? We anticipate getting the repairs done by this Thursday, but we're working very hard to try to accomplish that even earlier than we can.
Can you explain the mitigating factor of the old pipe and how that worked out?
Some of the challenges, there are things underground that you are out of sight, out of mind. And until you start to dig, you sometimes discover things that are just, you didn't really expect it to happen. In this case, as my crews were digging on Saturday, they encountered a 24-inch pipeline, which they thought was the original pipeline that was leaking. But it turned out to be an old, abandoned water line that was located almost directly on top of the line that was leaking. So we had to dig down, remove some of that old abandoned 24-inch water main to get to actually the real pipe that was really leaking. So surprise, surprise, when you dig, that's what happens in the world.
Anybody without water?
Unfortunately, right now we have 11 customers without water that are nearby. They have a water wagon for them, but we're going to be exploring different alternatives to provide them water service. Customers in East Honolulu are not affected at this time. We are fortunate that we have actually two 24-inch mains in this area serving East Honolulu. So this particular 24-inch main brings water from Palolo through our Keanu line booster. The other pipeline, the other 24-inch main comes across through around Diamond Head. So we're fortunate we have that second feed. Typically, cast iron pipe can last 70 or 80 years, maybe even 100 years. But that doesn't mean that the pipe won't have problems during its life. And we haven't had too many breaks in this pipeline. I don't remember in the last 30 or so years that I've been involved with the Board of Water Supply off and on that we've had a break in this particular location. But it can happen. To replace the line, we'll probably use something called ductile iron pipe that we can lower in there that has the same outside diameter as the cast iron pipe, so we can affect the repair. They don't make cast iron anymore. It was the newer material is called ductile iron. I just want to recognize our partners here. We've been very fortunate. It's been a great cooperative relationship between the city and the state. Behind me, I have Mark Kikuchi, the acting DTS director, actually he's over here, and we also have the deputy director for the State Department of Transportation, Ed Sniffen, and our Oahu district engineer, Pratt Kinimaka, from the Oahu district for state highways. And HPD is not here, but they've been great providing service support for us. I also want to recognize the mayor. Mayor has been out here personally to look at this site. He's very concerned about the impacts on traffic, and we understand that, and he's encouraging us to move as fast as we can. So I just want to say mahalo, everybody.
Ed, can I ask you a quick question? Ed, what can be done? I know we're watching about the traffic lanes over the state. Is there anything else you can do along the highway as far as like a
contra flow? So at this time, we're considering what our options are for a contra flow. Some of the difficulties that come into it, when we start trying to contra flow further back for a crossover, the lanes are slightly bifurcated when you go from one side to the other. Also, if we cut through the guardrails, we've got to put in end treatments to ensure that everybody's safe going through. So our engineers are working on it right now. They've been working on it since yesterday. But we know things that we can do very, very quickly is ensure that other routes are clear. So as of yesterday, we've asked all of our crews to shut down all of their projects going through Waimanalo to make sure that that route is a viable alternative for everybody coming through this area. We're also looking at all the permit work that we might have, other contractors or other agencies doing work on our highways, to make sure we clear those out as well. So as of today, those are all be out of the way to ensure that anyone coming through can reasonably go through Waimanalo as an alternative.
Some of the stories you heard, I heard Saturday and Sunday has been pretty bad. There's not a lot of options when it comes to something like this.
Absolutely. There's not a lot of options. And the good thing is, the thing is, on the weekends, we don't have any closures out there. So we could make sure that everything was clear as possible. We wanted to make sure that we could keep that going during the week as long as we need to make sure that we can clear the alternatives for everyone. Ernie reached out to us this weekend to make sure that we understood the time frames potentially that this repairs would require, which is why we got our engineers looking at other options for everyone now.
And Acting Department of Transportation Services Director Mark Yakuchi can talk about how folks can stay informed throughout the day.
Yeah. Hi. In cooperation with the state, we manage the traffic signals. The city manages the traffic signals. And we're with the cameras at Ainako and Cal Highway, we can correct it or coordinate it better. We can give maximum time to Cal Highway both ways. In the afternoon, we'll be giving maximum time for the commute home. We've also allowed the left turn in the morning from Ainako into Cal Highway, which normally is not done, but that's because we're rerouting the traffic through Malia down Ainako because this ramp is closed.
You want to mention Nixle and Go Akamai?
Yeah, you get, Nixle, you'll get, notices, whoever's on it. So that will give you, real-time information.
We also have the Go Akamai app.
State.
That folks can check.
There's a state.
Talk about the Go Akamai app. It's a good functional app.
So if you want to be kept up to speed on everything, please, prior to your trips, make sure you take a look online at Go Akamai or any website that gives you any traffic information. Pre-planning is the key for everybody. If you want to go Waze, Google, to any of the station's web pages to see what traffic information you can get prior to travel would be really, really good.
Again, the message is if you don't have to go through the area, please avoid the area if at all possible. We're going to expedite the repairs as soon as we can.
All the agencies involved in this coming forward, we're learning more information on possible contraflow opportunities, states suspending some of their projects as well, and the city trying to do its part as well to try and alert folks about not so much this morning's commute, because this morning's commute is moving along slowly, mm-hmm. but surely it's about this afternoon and the next several days.
Right, and they're going to try and get a second lane open by the afternoon commute. Mm-hmm. They're also going to synchronize the traffic lights out there on East Oahu to hopefully maximize the lane flow and hopefully get the traffic moving as much as possible.
In the meantime, crews will be working around the clock to try to expedite that repair. They're saying at least Thursday, hopefully sooner. We'll keep you posted.